Hello, I'm Carol Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's the bench.
And here's me. There's not always a bench. That's a metaphor. Here we go. Stupid. This is kind of fun.
You have to be pushy
and
yes,
and know when not to apologize.
Yes, I remember standing in. I was taken into one of the senior people at Royal Academy of Music because I was on the performance course, and they wanted me to go out and teach music, be on the graduate course, and I remember just standing there, really small, just holding my ground, saying.
Yes, I want
to be a concert organist.
Yes, well, very sensible. Yes, good.
Yeah. Do you remember Kevin Bayer?
Yes, I've met him once or twice. Yes.
Yes.
Was he at the academy with you?
He was leaving. His last year is my first year.
Right.
He studied with Douglas Hawkridge too.
Did he?
He studied with him a lot more than I did.
Yes. Very able player.
This afternoon I have a very, very special interview for On the Bench with Dr. Carol, somebody who's, to me, very important. You were my first classical organ teacher, Philip Moore. Thank you so much for having a chat with us.
It's lovely to see you and to be in touch with you after so many years.
I know. And to meet in Paris like this.
I know.
I know. It's fabulous, isn't it?
Fantastic,
You've
yes.
done so much with your art. I mean, tell us about, the first question I often ask eminent musicians is, when do you remember the first time you heard an organ and what it did for you?
Well, the first time I heard an organ would have been when I was taken to church as a child.
Yes.
And this was at a church in Hertfordshire, Christchurch Cockfosters.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't have any children's church there at all, but I was always taken out before the sermon. Which was very sensible of my parents. But it was always the organ and also the choir that fascinated me.
Yes.
There was a very good adult choir there.
Yes.
They always sang an anthem.
Mm-hmm.
And the vicar would sit quietly while after the anthem had finished.
Yes.
And it would all sink in.
Yes.
And then I would just be absorbed by the sound of the voluntary.
Yes.
And then I think... My mother and father were very musical, and they had what, for those days, was a fairly upmarket record player.
Oh.
And I remember one of the first 78 records I got was George Thalben Ball playing Cargill
That. Oh, really?
And I used to play that a lot.
Yes. So how old were you at that early age of hearing the organ?
I suppose I was about six.
And then what did you start learning first?
I learned the piano to begin with.
Yes.
And my father was a very good pianist, and
yes.
he taught me up to grade five.
Yes.
He wasn't a professional pianist, but he had an extremely good piano teacher when he was younger.
Mm-hmm.
My mother, although she had piano lessons, was extremely good at playing by ear.
Yes.
So from both mother and father, there was a lot of music around.
Yes.
And then we moved to Maidstone in Kent, and I got up to grade five, and then learnt the organ with the local organist of the parish church in Maidstone,
right.
who was not well known, Maxwell Menges, but he was a remarkable musician.
Mm-hmm.
He was a superb improviser,
yeah.
And Before he went to Maidstone, he was at St. Michael's Tenbury, mm-hmm. and one of our late contemporary composers in this country, in England, Jonathan Harvey, mm-hmm. He had an inspiration as a chorister at St. Michael's Tenbury through one of Maxwell Menge's improvisations. And I knew exactly what he meant when I heard him say this.
Yes.
But I just, you know, I just took to the organ like a duck to water,
yes.
really.
And then you went to the Royal College of Music.
Then I went to the Royal College of Music.
Yes.
And then I needed a job, so I, as one does. So I taught music at Eton,
mm-hmm. wow.
Which was a lovely place to be because there were some very fine organs there.
Yes.
In the chapel, in the college chapel, there's a very fine hill.
Yes.
Which has not really been very drastically altered.
Yeah.
And various other organs in the school. But I really wanted to get into cathedrals.
Yeah.
So I applied and got the assistantship at Canterbury.
What did that entail?
Getting the job.
Yes.
An interview.
Yes.
That was it.
That was it.
Yeah. There was no putting us through our paces. Well... No. Alan Wicks, the organist, who was a very fine player, a wonderful musician.
I remember hearing him live.
Yeah, well, he did a lot of contemporary music, mm-hmm. but he was also a fabulous choir trainer.
Yeah.
And he said to us all, well, you've all got FRCO, so you can all play the organ, I imagine. And that was it, you know. So there was no question of sitting us down.
So you went in as the assistant organist.
Yes.
Which is basically, not basically, but you play everything.
I played pretty well everything. And the repertoire at Canterbury was very big.
Mm-hmm.
And the situation at the cathedral with the organ was difficult. Mm-hmm. The console is on the screen. The organ pipes are up in a triforum gallery.
Mm-hmm.
There was no closed circuit television.
Wow.
There were no earphones. To follow the beat, I had to do that.
You had to watch.
Yeah. So I can still play the start of Howells Coleraig, Gloria.
Yes.
I can still play it like that because you had to watch.
Yes.
The conductor, because the trebles.
Yeah.
Hold a high note, and you don't know where the rest of the men are because you can't hear them. And the organ is blasting at you.
Yes.
So it was a very, very difficult situation.
That must have been.
And you had to play ahead of the beat.
Yes. So how much ahead of the beat?
Well, it would have been probably a quarter of a second.
Yeah,
but you're fine in Stanford in C.
Yes.
But if you were playing Stanford in G, it was pop, 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 pop,
yes.
pop, pop, pop. You just start, and then you just have to hope for the best.
Yes. Wow,
I mean, it was very difficult.
That's one of the most eminent cathedrals in the United Kingdom.
Well, it is.
It's a beautiful cathedral.
Yes, right? Yes.
And when would you have rehearsed? It's a big tourist place, like Notre Dame.
Yes,
you know,
it
right?
is.
When did you get to rehearse somewhere like that?
We were allowed to rehearse quietly in the afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And then anything loud I would do at night time.
Did you go in there much at night to rehearse?
Yes,
that must have been special.
Wonderful. Yes,
special time with that organ late at night on your own.
Yes.
A lot of ghosts in that building, maybe.
No, it was a it was a friendly building. Actually.
Yes, yes,
yes.
Well, and then from there you went
from
to
there,
Guildford.
I went to Guildford where we met.
Yes, yes, I remember those lessons.
Yes.
Do you know what I remember special though was that you would allow me to rehearse in the cathedral. With my dad, nobody else. And that was my first experience for getting to know a major organ in a major building. And we came to every concert at that place.
You did, yes.
And it was just, that was, to me, a turning point in my career to be close to a big organ.
Mm.
Yes. Mm. Did you love the organ?
It was a difficult organ to play, actually. It was not... it was a second-hand organ, actually. People didn't make a lot of this, but it was a Harrison from a Baptist or a Methodist church in Shipley in Yorkshire.
Mm.
And it was put in and extended by Rushworth and Draper.
Right.
And it was not the loveliest of instruments.
No.
It had its good qualities. And my late cousin, Duncan Johnston, who you remember from your days at St. Columbus, he was very good at all sorts of things. And one of the things he was skilled at was showing how you could get the best out of an organ which was not of the greatest quality.
Yes.
And you discovered the Guildford organ and what it could do and what it couldn't do.
I think I was too young to. I mean, everything was fantastic.
Yes, yes.
Now, there's the same architect inside, wasn't it, as at St. Columba's? Because I remember the white walls and the blue.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes. Edward Morph. Edward Morph.
Yes, I remember that.
Yes.
So from then on, you went to...
To York Minster.
York Minster, wow.
Where I was privileged to take over from Francis Jackson, who is now 99.
Yes.
And in still very good form.
That's amazing, isn't it?
Wonderful man.
Yes.
And a wonderful player, because he stopped reciting about 5 years ago. But I remember his last recital. Amongst other things, he played the Prelude and Fugue in G major. And it was absolutely rock steady the whole way through.
And he'd be 94
years
old.
He would have been 94 or so.
Wow.
And I don't think there were any muff notes at all. And it just had his playing, especially his Bach and César Franck, had a sense of spaciousness about it. It was partly playing in a huge building like York Minster, where you have to allow the building to let the music speak.
Yeah.
But he gives music a sense of space and time.
Yes.
And you can just feel yourself almost relaxing into the music. It's wonderful.
How old is York Minster as a building?
Well, it was finished in about 1490.
Gosh.
But it was begun in the 1300s.
Yes.
And there are bits of the old Minster which you can see still, which were Norman.
And who built the organ there?
It was the basic organ you see there. The case was by Elliot and Hill, and then Hill redid it.
Mm-hmm.
Walker's in 1901,
mm-hmm.
Harrison's 14 and 28,
yes,
and then Walker's again in 61,
yes,
and Geoffrey Coffin of Principal Pipe Organs did it in 90.
Right.
It's had a checkered history, but because the building is very fine, and there's still a lot of very fine Hill and Walker work in it.
Yes.
Walker from 1901.
Yes.
It still sounds beautiful.
Yes.
Some wonderful solo stops, especially.
Yes. And what is the acoustic length there? And how?
It's about 5 seconds resonance.
Oh, must be.
It's more in the nave than in the choir, but it's not like St. Paul's where everything is awash.
Yes.
Yes. You can make music in the building without
it's
feeling,
clear.
Yes, you've got a certain amount of clarity.
It's a wonderful building.
It's a beautiful building.
Yes. How long were you there?
I was there for 25 years.
Wow, that must have been. What was it like when you did the first service there? Do you remember that very first?
I do.
What was it? Well, go on, tell us.
Well, these days, when a new organist goes to a new church or cathedral, he's installed. And they make a little bit of a fuss about it. I just walked in and conducted my first service, having rehearsed the choir beforehand in the previous few days. So I just walked in and...
Nothing was said?
No. It was extraordinary. But in some ways, the fact that it wasn't highlighted as such meant that the importance of worship was highlighted. You know, this is just another service, another offering of prayer and praise.
Yes.
Which was part of the daily routine of services.
Yes, yes.
And I just, as it were, I just slotted myself into the round of worship that had gone on there for 100 and many, many hundreds of years.
I know.
So it was a strange, unfussy start.
Unfussy, then. And not only a fine organist, you're also an exquisite composer.
Well, you're very kind.
No, but that building must have, I'm not saying must have, but has that building affected your work?
Yes.
In what way?
I think giving time to cadences.
Yes.
I think it's very easy in the confines of your study when you're composing to write in too constricted a way.
Yes.
And I think a big building helps you to expand work that you're, the way in which you arrange the material.
Yes, savour it.
Yeah, yes. And actually Stanford was very good on this. He's got a very good book called Musical Composition.
Mm.
And he said in it, don't write a rallentando, I'm paraphrasing him, don't write a rallentando, just extend the notes.
Yeah.
And if you look, for instance, at the end of his Nunc Dimittis in A, the notes become longer and longer and longer. He doesn't put rallentando.
Right. Yes.
The notes are just extended. And,
yes.
And that gives the... That is suitable for a good building.
Yes.
And my predecessor, Francis, is a very good composer as well.
Mm.
And his music savours par excellence.
Yes.
A big building.
Yes. How many works have you composed?
Well, it runs into many hundreds.
Yes. And many performances in the States.
Yes, there are.
And you've been over for the premieres.
Yes, I have.
You've composed with like York Minster in your mind, and maybe the work is then transformed to a church or cathedral in the States with very little acoustics.
Mm.
How do you deal with that?
You have to hope that people will adhere to the metronome marks.
Yes.
And I always put Circa 72, about 72.
Yes.
And you just hope that people will get the right margin of error, for tempo.
Yes.
I don't think... If you go to a very large acoustic... it doesn't necessarily dictate a much slower tempo.
Mm.
If you transpose a piece to a dead building,
you
don't necessarily want it a lot faster.
No.
Because I find that a wrong speed in a performance of my piece is much worse than any wrong notes.
Yes, I get that.
I'm happy if the speed is right.
Yes.
If the balance is wrong, well,
yes,
that would be nice to have the balance right.
Yes.
But if the speed is wrong...
Yeah, it loses the whole character.
It loses the whole character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I once said to somebody, he'd done a nice-ish performance of something of mine, but it was too fast. I said, I didn't put the metronome mark on just for fun. But on the other hand, you have, with any composer, you have to decide whether he's guessed it or whether it's actually what he means. And Stanford said, when I put Crotchet 100 on the Magnificat in C, I meant Crotchet 100.
Right.
And it's very slow. Howells, on the other hand, used to guess them. And I discovered that when I played him Master Tallis' Testament.
Mm-hmm.
And I got it down to... quaver, what do you call that in America?
Eighth note.
Eighth note is 60, I think.
Yeah.
And I started off. Immediately he said, move it on, move it on.
Yes.
So obviously he guessed the metronome marks.
Yes.
And somebody once told me that he did.
I was thinking, because last night I played all of Vierne's Third Symphony, and one reason why I wanted to do it was really get to know that piece of music in that building.
Yes.
So to me it was like almost like an organ lesson for me.
Yes, yes.
But some of those metronome markings just don't work.
No.
And I don't... The building, in the end, if you're lucky enough to play the work in the building that it was conceived, for me always kind of dictates to me the speed.
Yes, it does.
The organ.
And you were a little bit under the metronome marks, were you?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes,
rightly so.
Yes, especially that building has so much acoustic, and it just, you have to let the building breathe.
Yes, you do.
Yes,
you do, and which you did.
Yeah,
to great effect.
Thank you very much. Yeah,
it was a lovely recital.
Thank you. So now you are the president of the Royal College of Organists.
I am. Yes.
Wow.
Yes, which is a great honour.
Yes.
Not one I'd expected at all.
Can we ask how did that
I just received an email one day saying, would you consider it?
Yes.
I did my AR and FR exams.
Oh, my, I remember those.
Yeah, terrifying. Many, many years ago. And yes. I wrote a few papers about 10, 15 years ago for them. Mm. And I did a bit of marking. Mm. And otherwise, I didn't do examining at all, you know. But they decided that my name should go forward.
Yes.
And I thought about it very hard before doing so, before accepting. Mm. But I'm very glad to have done so, because it's been a great insight into...
What does it involve?
It's an amorphous role, really, and you're a representative of the college in various forms. You have to... There are two specific things you have to do, or one... is to dish out the diplomas at the conferment ceremony, and you have to write a presidential address. Mm. You have to write in the newsletter, I think once or twice a year. Mm-hmm. I'm also writing a piece for the RCO Journal about Francis Jackson's choral music. Mm. But otherwise, I think you're just there to represent the college as a sort of figurehead.
Right.
And... I've been to some of the RCO events just to support, you know, and to encourage the younger members.
Mm-hmm. Has the exam system remained pretty much the same as it was when I took the exams?
No, there are various changes.
In what way?
Well, they've changed some of the
tests
and the paperwork. Right. You have to do figured base now, or you can do figured base, which is a good option.
Yes,
And there's also... a lower grade thing beneath ARCO, which is very well worth doing for somebody who wants to get a kind of affirmation of progress without actually going through a very all the very difficult hoops that you have to go through.
Is the paperwork exam still about 6 hours?
Yes.
Oh, I remember that.
Yes. It's often the paperwork that people... find hardest.
Yes, I remember struggling with the fugues.
Yes, I know. Yeah, but it's worth doing.
It is worth doing. And
It gives you a very good overall taste of music.
Yes.
And one of the things I learnt from Alan at Wicks especially was and also from Duncan, was the importance of having your ear tuned to music other than organ music.
Yes.
And of course, I was obviously very involved with the choir
in
Stranraer at Guildford.
Yes.
But one of the lovely things at York was that I conducted the York Musical Society, which is a big choral society. Mm-hmm. So I conducted big pieces and symphonies and so forth. And that was a big thrill.
Yeah.
Totally different from playing the organ or conducting a choir.
Do you have a favourite part of music, or is it everything?
Yes, I like most periods, actually.
Yes,
You know, I think, I mean, if I would have to say Desert Island Piece, it would be probably the Mass in B Minor of Bach.
Yes.
If there was one piece I had to take away. But I'm extremely fond of Vaughan Williams. Used to write Vaughan Williams and Water.
Yes. We get a lot of students watching the series, and what would be your advice to somebody thinking about being an organist, choir director? What would be your advice?
Being an organist, make sure you have a good piano technique. I think that's very important, and continue to play the piano. I love playing the piano. I've got a beautiful Bluthner at home.
Nice.
Because you get a feeling of where phrases are going in the way that you have in a sense to fudge the phrase, not fudge, but you have to get an accent on a note.
Yeah.
You have to detach the previous one on the organ, whereas on a piano you can weigh into it and so forth.
Yes.
To deal with a choir, the best way is to do it.
Yes.
But to see if you can get something from a really good choir trainer. And learn from listening to people's rehearsals.
Yes.
That's also terribly important. And also having a sense of what the whole church that you're working in is about.
Yeah.
You know, you've got to have some sense of the sort of worship that's offered in a particular place.
Do you get time for hobbies?
Yes.
What do you do for other than music?
Well, I've taken to gardening. I'm not very good at it, but when I've time, I collect fountain pens. that's a conversation starter.
It is, isn't it?
Yes.
Really?
One of my colleagues, Barry Rose, my predecessor at Guildford,
yes.
He's a fountain pen collector.
Are they old fountain pens?
Some of them, yeah.
Are they from famous people?
Yes, mostly. A lot of Parkers. And
are they from famous people?
No, not famous people, but well-known makes.
Yes, yes.
I love visiting art galleries and buildings, architecture.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a whenever I'm in London for an RCO meeting, I always try to visit a gallery.
Yes, that's lovely. Well, Philip, thank you so much for joining us on the bench. It's been such a pleasure chatting with you and seeing you again. Thank you so much.
It was my pleasure indeed, Carol. Thank you so much for asking me to be interviewed.
Thank you.